These are African rhythms passed down to us through ancient.
This is Africa World Nail Project. I'm your host and producer, James Pope. Today, a deep exploration of maroons in the United States with Dr. Nubia Kai. With her recent book, I Spread My Wings and I Fly. Africa World Nail Project is next. Cimarrón originally referred to domestic cattle that had taken to the hills in Hispaniola. It was gradually expanded to be applied to enslaved indigenous peoples who had escaped from the Spaniards as they colonized South and Central America as well as the Caribbean. By the end of the 1530s, the concept had taken on strong connotations of being fierce, wild, and unbroken, and was transferred to be primarily applied to Africans and people of African descent, or the runaways as they were referred to. For more than four centuries, the communities formed by such escaped enslaved peoples dotted the fringes of plantations in the Americas, from Brazil to southeastern United States, from Peru to the U.S. Southwest. Known variously as quilombos, or mocambos, or mambeses, these new societies ranged from tiny bands that survived less than a year to powerful states that numbered thousands of members who survived for generations, even centuries. Their descendants still form semi-independent enclaves in several parts of the hemisphere, as found in present-day communities in Suriname, French Guiana, Jamaica, Colombia, and Belize. Maroon communities consisted of escaped peoples with origins from a wide range of societies in West and Central Africa. At the onset, they shared neither language nor major aspects of culture. Their collective task was to create new communities and institutions through various processes of integrating cultural elements drawn largely from this variety in African societies, in order to understand the ease in which these communities seamlessly evolve. Kwame Jeche's work on the deep continuities of cultural elements that link African societies is important to note here. One of the best examples in this collective task is found in the political system of the great 17th century Brazilian Maroon community of Palmares, which has often been characterized as an African state. For generations, historians believe that the most remarkable of Maroon settlements in North America did not rival the achievements of Maroon communities in South America as well as the Caribbean. However, according to a number of scholars, such as Cedric Robinson, Gerald Mullen, as well as Herbert Aptheker, and most recently, Joff, evidence of the existence of at least 50 such communities in various places at various times from 1672 to 1864 has been documented to have existed in the United States. Herbert Aptheker's work points out that the first Maroon communities predated Jamestown settlements by 82 years. They were African insurrectionists who secured their freedom from abortive Spanish colonizing efforts in North and South Carolina. Maroon communities were a real presence in the United States. Aptheker goes on to highlight their presence in 19th century Virginia, Georgia, Alabama, Louisiana, South Carolina, as well as Wake, Gates, Onslow, Blayton, Sampson, Jones, New Hanover, Dublin, Wilmington, Robeson, and Nash counties, North Carolina. Today, Africa World Nail Project will bring you a conversation I recently had with Dr. Nubia Kai, where we discussed her recent historical novel titled I Spread My Wings and I Fly. Dr. Kai is a cultural worker, artist, activist, scholar, and retired professor from Howard University. Her work has been published in Black Scholar, Black American Literature Forum, and the Journal of the African Literature Association. As historian and poet, Dr. Kai has won a number of awards and honors, which include the Michigan Arts Council Award, DC Commission of the Arts Award, and National Endowment for the Arts Award, just to name a few. I Spread My Wings and Fly is an important contribution to the work that is being done to explore the connections between culture, resistance, and the science of metaphysics as a source of liberatory practice as found in the historical and cultural practice of the Maroons. These processes and their elements are found within every corner of African diasporic socio-political thought and cultural practices from Brazil to Colombia, to the Black Church here in the United States. Our show was produced today in solidarity with the Native, Indigenous, and Afro-descendant communities at Standing Rock, Venezuela, Brazil, Colombia, Kenya, South Africa, and Ghana, and other places who are fighting for the protection of our land for the benefit of all peoples. Enjoy the program. Heroic songs unsung. Forgive them, Father. They know there's not as undone. Tied with the rope that my grandmother died. Pride of the pilgrims affect lives of millions. In slave days, separating fathers from children. Institution ain't just a building, but a method of having black and brown bodies fill them. We ain't seen as human beings with feelings. Will the U.S. ever be us, Lord willing? For now we know the new Jim Crow, to stop, search, and arrest our souls. Police and policies patrol, philosophies of control. A cruel hand taking hold. We let go to free them so we can free us. America's moment to come to Jesus. Free. Yes, I'm here today with Dr. Nubia Kai, who is an activist scholar and retired professor from Howard University. Welcome.
Oh, thank you so much, Dr. Pope. I know you said not to call you Dr. Pope, but I'm going to call you Dr. Pope.
that's quite fine. That's quite all right. I really appreciate that.
Okay.
I appreciate that. So you have written a number of books, and one of the books that we're going to talk about today in your scholarly endeavors is a book that you've recently written. It came out last year. I believe it was in November. Am I correct?
It came out in March of this year.
And this book was written on the Maroon community.
Right.
What inspired you to write about the Maroon here in the United States?
Okay. Well, I have to say that the book, I just published it this year, but I actually finished the book in 1985. Mm-hmm. So this over 30 years ago that I completed the book. The idea to do the book came in 1972, right after I gave birth to my daughter. And I don't know. I don't know what it is. Maybe when you have this birth, it's like a burst of creative energy that comes with the birth of a child. And it was then that I got the idea to do a novel. I wanted to do a novel about slavery, kind of an epic novel. But I wanted it to focus on the Maroons in the United States. Now, at that time, I was writing poetry, and I think I had done a few one-act plays, but I had never written any fiction. So I started by writing short stories. Eventually, I worked up to a novella, and then eventually the novel, the epic novel, I Spread My Wings and I Fly, which I completed in 1985. I actually started the writing in, I think, 1978. Meanwhile, from the time 1972, I was doing research for the novel and honing my writing skills. So I wanted to do this because I knew that there were Maroons in the United States, but I knew there was very little information about the Maroons in the United States. And I also had read about Maroons in the Caribbean and South America, which there were many, as you know. And there were many texts and plays and even films about the Maroons in Brazil, Suriname, Guyana, Venezuela, Colombia, Jamaica, Haiti, Cuba, but nothing about Maroons in the United States. And I think there was an impression, even among a number of scholars, that there were no Maroons in the United States. And so that was one of the reasons I wanted to do this, because I knew this is something that really had not been explored. And it really wasn't until recently, that was 2014, that Sylvian Jolf, who was an archivist at the Schoenberg Center, came out with a comprehensive work about the Maroons in the United States. As far as I know, that is the first text that's been done, a complete book about the Maroons. Herbert Aptheker, he talks about the Maroons in his seminal text, I think it came out in the 1970s, the 250 slave revolts, American Negro slave revolts. And then, of course, Vincent Harding, who passed recently, who did the wonderful text, There is a River, who talks a little about the Maroons there. But there had never been a novel, a historical novel about Maroons, as far as I know. This is the first one. And another reason why I chose to do this form, because when I started studying and getting information, doing research, I realized that there were a lot of Maroon communities. I mean, it was far more extensive than I thought, and I was focusing on Louisiana. And I realized, wow, I mean, this could be a text. This was before Joe's book had come out, a scholarly text, and I felt there was a need for something like that. But I chose this form because when you use the creative form, like a novel or poetry or play, you're able to engage the audience on an emotional and a spiritual level. Whereas when you're just dealing with an expository text, you're not getting that same emotional and spiritual engagement, right? So you actually can see what the culture was like, what the people were like, what their national personality, their customs, their moral standards and ethical standards, all of these things we don't necessarily get in an expository historical text. So I think this is one of the best forms for conveying history is through a creative art form, like a historical novel, when we're dealing with history. And it also simulates the form that's used in Africa, right? Because I did my my dissertation on the Mandinka griot tradition, and there's a conflation between the aesthetic and the expository in the explication of history there. That's why people will say, oh, well, they're storytellers. No, they're not storytellers. They're historians. But they tell history as though it's a story, right? They bring in the dramatic elements. They bring in the poetry, all right? They bring in the dance and the music so that, again, the audience is engaged, you know, vicariously in the experience, in the action that's taking place, and is engaged emotionally and psychologically and spiritually. So that's why I use this form. And, again, it is definitely an African historiographic form.
No, that's very, very important. And there were a number of things that we're going to try to pull on what you just said, because you're talking about the idea of storytelling, but also underneath this particular idea of storytelling is we can say that it's art as a weapon, using art as a weapon to transform consciousness, right?
Absolutely. Very well put, yes.
So this historical novel, and I agree with you because it reads very well. It reads like a novel, but it is truly a historical because, again, as a scholar myself, this idea that you started research in 1972 pops out to me, right? But it's also the idea that you are trying to tell a story, but you have some concepts here. You said national personality. You talked about ethical standards. What is it, or what are some of the concepts that you would like the readers to kind of get? Maybe give me one or two, or let's deal with the national personality of the Maroons through this particular form that you have presented to people to read on this historical novel. Let's talk about the national personality. What are some of the things that we can get from reading your text that kind of gives us an understanding of what the Maroons were doing in their particular historical space?
Okay, yes. I would say, and I hadn't really analyzed it like that, even though that is one of the things we're looking at. The national personality, I would say, of the Maroons is, first of all, one of courage. Mm. Courage would be one of their characteristics. Tremendous faith, courage, hope, and these are things that we find really in African Americans in general, enslaved Africans in general. I would add, though, with the Maroons, in many cases, or especially particularly in the novel, where I'm situating the novel in Louisiana, where there was still a lot of knowledge of African metaphysical systems, they had a great amount of wisdom. A tremendous amount of wisdom and a tremendous amount of knowledge coming from Africa, the epistemological knowledge, which was called voodoo or voodoo. In the United States, it was called voodoo. And I was attending a lecture recently by a Mambo priest who was speaking of voodoo in this way. And then we also have Wade Noble's recent text about the history of the mims, the science of mims, in which he's talking about voodoo and the revolution in Haiti and how it precipitated the revolution in Haiti. Here, people had this knowledge of the unseen, or as Wade Nobles calls it, the science of spirit. Mm-hmm. So they had an understanding of how to manipulate the elements, fire, earth, air, and water, how to manipulate even what we call maybe time and space, manipulation of time and space, how to go to transform themselves, transforms objects, including themselves. I guess you could say shapeshifters is another way of putting that. This is the type of knowledge that many of the Maroons, particularly in Louisiana, had, because many of them had come from directly from Africa, and many of them had come from Haiti. You know, this is, and even though the novel is set in the 1850s, I think it should be remembered that even though the African slave trade was abolished in 1807 by the British, there was still an illegal slave trade that was going on, and which thousands, even hundreds of thousands of enslaved Africans were still being imported and brought into the United States, particularly into New Orleans, which was the second largest port city in America. So you still had many Africans coming in the 1830s and 1840s. According to W.B. Du Bois, in his text, The Suppression of the African Slave Trade, the largest number of enslaved Africans were imported in that last decade before the Civil War, 1850 to 1860, the largest number. So you had these, again, these enslaved Africans coming from Africa, and many who had come from Haiti before and even after the revolution who had this knowledge. So that was also part of the Maroon. Now, in terms of their character, another aspect of their customs, you notice that they would be wearing, like, dreadlocks. We think the dreadlocks are new. They're not. Of course, it's an ancient practice. When we were in Kemet, they had dreadlocks. The ancient Kemetans wore dreadlocks, and they had all the dreadlocks taking pictures with the, you know, the wigs. They had, like, these dreadlock wigs, right? And we were taking pictures next to him. You see the same hairstyle. So a lot of the Maroons wore the dreadlocks. A lot of them wore rings in their ears. A lot of them, they wore gri-gri, which gri-gri was like a what do you call it? It's the other name for it, something to protection, something that they wore on their body to protect them. I want to say talisman. They often carried canes with the African carvings on it. They, even though the drums had been banned in most parts of the United States, in Louisiana, parts of Louisiana, especially in New Orleans, they were still permitted to play drums. And in the Maroon camps and villages, they also used drums for signals. And so this is, again, another facet of the Maroon culture, Maroon lore. They also had rituals that were done, rituals that were practiced in Haiti and in Africa, because I talk about the myth of Asar and Aset, which was practiced even by Africans who were here before Columbus, and it was kind of taken up by, you know, the Africans who first were brought into Louisiana. So you see them reenacting ancient myths, the myths of Asar and Aset, which, again, were still practiced here. I got that from Sertima's text. By the way, they came before Columbus, and the deity of Desiree, which I equate with Asar or Osiris. So you see them engaged in these ancient African rituals. They're very knowledgeable, very self-reliant, very resilient, love of family, love of their people. All of these attributes we find in the Maroon character and in the Maroon culture.
No, that's very important, because when we think about history and when we think about making texts, or we're thinking about studying, a lot of times we do not necessarily pay attention or pay enough attention to the metaphysical systems that were also an empowering aspect of liberation. Because, of course, the ethical orientation, we can also say that seeking liberation from oppressive systems is very, very important. You need something that kind of moves you along on that freedom continuum, right?
Exactly, exactly. And that's exactly what happened in Haiti. And of course, the authorities all over America were terrified of another Haitian revolution taking place in America, or any other place in South America or the Caribbean. They were really terrified, because that was no small feat, what happened in Haiti. And truly, it was the metaphysical system of voodoo, which, as the sister said, the voodoo really combines the metaphysical systems of 51 different African nations. So, for example, you would have the voodoo Yoruba, or the voodoo Arada, or the voodoo Wolof, or the voodoo Congolese, or the voodoo Luanda, or the voodoo mandinka, you understand, so forth.
Mm-hmm.
51 different metaphysical systems combined that were specifically designed to attain their liberation.
Let me ask you, let's go to the text. What in your text that kind of that you can share with us that kind of gives us a kind of sense of you transmitting this particular, not this particular, but some of these concepts that we're talking about? Now, we only talked about two, and you mentioned about a number of them, but how are you constructing this text for our listeners who have not had a chance to go get the book yet, but they're going to go get it soon? How are you constructing, how you're telling the story with the characters?
Okay. The story really begins on the plantation, and the central character is a man by the name of Caleb, and I guess his current slave master's name was Hollyfield, which is, as you can see, means really like holy field. So Caleb is young, I think maybe in his mid-20s, enslaved African who grew up in a Maroon community. This is what's significant about his history. He grew up in a Maroon community with his mother and father, maybe the first 5 or 6 years of his life, but he remembers it very well. And then the Maroon community was invaded by patrols. His father was captured and killed, and he and his mother were sent back to the slave owner on a farm in southern Louisiana. But he always has this quest to be free and to maybe find another Maroon camp. But he has this quest and this desire to be free, and he's what they call a chronic runaway, or runagate or a cut.
Mm-hmm.
So he's constantly running away, which is why he's being sold from plantation to plantation, from farm to farm. Because even though there was a law in Louisiana that if an enslaved person ran away 3 times, they were automatically executed or killed, if they had enforced that law, they wouldn't have had any more enslaved people. All right,
that's important.
That's important. That's how many people were running away.
Right, right.
They couldn't enforce their law, so usually they would just sell them to somebody else who didn't know how dangerous this person was or that they were likely to run. And I want to say something when I talk about Maroon. Maroon here, the way I try to use it in the novel, I use it as like a trope for a resistance, whether armed resistance or unarmed resistance, and for self-determination. It's a trope.
Okay.
So that you can find the Maroon spirit, the Maroon sensibility, or the Maroon spirit, for example, in an enslaved person who's in the home, or what they call a house slave, or a field hand, or a child for that matter. So we can see it in, you see what I'm saying, it manifests in different people. You have all these different characters. So in certain respect, it's like a Bildungs Roman type of novel where he's kind of coming of age through all experiences that he goes through, even though he's already, you know, grown and like 25. But he really gains a knowledge and wisdom when he finally ends up in this Maroon camp. Now, he goes through a lot of experiences even before he reaches the Maroon camp, because I don't know if you've read the novel, but he goes and he runs into a juju man.
Mm-hmm.
Because you had a lot of very, very powerful voodoo priests and voodoo queens in Louisiana. And believe me, they pretty much controlled things there because of the power that they had.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And so this guy, Jobo, he spends time with, and he's working with him, takes him through a lot of changes, but he learns a lot through that experience. And then when he's with the Maroons, he learns even more. So you see him going through all the experience. The Maroon camp breaks up for a while. They kind of have to lay low, you know, after they go through a battle with the patrols and the militias. And see, these are based on, even though I'm creating these things, these episodes and events, the story is true. It's something they say about historical novels that they say on the margins, right? The show that Ethelbert is doing now. They used to say that with the historical novel, the events didn't happen, but the story is true.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah, no, that's very important. And my goodness, at this particular point, I think I have to stop you because we want to tease them. We want to tease our listeners too, because you set up a very, very powerful narrative here, because what is important, I think, just in this conversation is everything that you just said. But I wanted to highlight one of the points that you're making with the idea of maroon as a trope that represents characteristics, because what ends up happening is it allows us to track its genealogy, right?
Okay, yes.
So it allows us to look at the international dimensions of the transmitting of cultural systems and language, and how it morphs through different experiences. And that's what you're doing. You're following, you're using your character, the maroon as a trope and the maroon as a community, as experiential, but also how one is conceptualizing reality.
Yes, and it is. So, because clearly you see people who are still on the plantation who have the spirit of a maroon, but they're still on the plantation. But you still see that they have that maroon spirit and that maroon sensibility.
There's one of the things, I mean, we're talking about situating this historical novel and this historical narrative in Louisiana. But one of the things that I am super interested in is how the maroons used land. You talked about the metaphysical systems. And one of the things that we know specifically when we're talking about resistance and we're talking about the ideas that are transmitted in Africana, in the African world, the centrality of one's relationship to land becomes important as well, right?
Oh, exactly, exactly. And in the situation with the Maroons community that I'm focusing on in the novel, it's really a very small community of mainly fighters. In fact, it's 12 men, and I think with Caleb, it's 13. And there's a leader who's just, again, this very spiritual type of mystical person, Yami, who is the leader of the Maroons. But you can tell they have this very close relationship with the land, and with the land, and with the flora, and with the fauna, and with the native peoples that also live in the area. But you know, you had different types of maroon communities depending on the location and depending on what they were dealing with, what, you know, if they were fighting the militia, if the patrols were really on them, it varied. So in this particular community, it's very kind of loosely, they're kind of on the move, very nomadic. They're moving all over the state. So they're living in what we call bailiwicks. And that was a term for a dwelling, and usually was a dwelling that was just kind of composed out of branches and vines and other things that they could put together to kind of construct a house. And in some cases, you had tents, bailiwicks and tents. They're mainly living in bailiwicks and tents. Other rural communities, like we learned in Sylvia and Job's book, where they dug caves, especially in the dismal swamps, they would dig these caves and lived underground. Whole families lived underground in these underground caves. And then you have other communities in Louisiana, South Carolina, Georgia, and especially in Florida with the Seminole Maroons, the Black Seminoles, who lived pretty much in the open as farmers and farms. They had farming communities. You know, they had their tikis, which were like the Seminole houses made of wood and which the thatched roofs. But they raised cattle, they raised hogs, they raised sheep and poultry, and then they planted corn and pumpkins and yams and all other kinds of food. So they were into agriculture and pretty much farming and lived in the open. Depending, again, like I say, on where the camps were situated, like in the hinterland, sometimes you had communities that were able to do that. But the Maroons in my novel, again, very close relationship with the land and very intuitive knowledge almost of the plants and the herbs in their surrounding areas. Like they knew the foods that were edible, they knew the foods that were poisonous, they used poison arrows in their fight with the militias so that anywhere the arrow hit, the person would die. So it didn't matter. It was more powerful than the gun. And one of the characters says, you know, this is more powerful because anywhere they hit, they're going to die from the poison. They also could poison the water supply, and this is another way in which they were able to entrap the militias by poisoning the water, but then at the same time they could provide an antidote. And I'd like to refer to Harriet Tubman, who was also a great herbalist and a great artist in addition to all the other things she did. She said that, you know, she found different herbs to heal dysentery when she was working as a nurse and a spy in the Civil War. And one of the things she said, and this is something that her family has passed on to us, that wherever the disease was found, that the antidote was right there, right next to where the disease was. And that's the way it always worked, right?
Mm-hmm.
Wherever there was a disease, the antidote was right in the same vicinity as the disease. She was able to find these different herbs that could cure them. They also said that she used penicillin. She used this mold long before the doctor, whatever the doctor's name was, who supposedly, Fleming was it, I think, who developed penicillin. She was already using this mold to heal people, to cure fevers and colds and other things. So the Maroons had this very acute knowledge of herbs and plants for healing, for eating, poisoning. They could use it as a weapon. They also had knowledge and control over animals. They, you know, had various interactions with birds, like the peregrines. They could send messages with the birds. They had knowledge of insects, communications with insects. So, and this comes out in the novel. Even Caleb, who, before he even enters the Maroon camp, you see this close relationship that he has with nature and how he's able to read signs in the stars and in the birds and in the insects and plants. He knows this because this is just kind of general knowledge among enslaved Africans of the 19th century. It really was a whole different kind of epistemology that our people had at that time in the 19th century in general, whether we were Maroons or not. But his knowledge is kind of honed and developed further, much further, when he spends time in the Maroon camp.
No, that's very, very important. And share something with our listeners that kind of gives us a sense of what they will be exposed to, not only within the context of just the great in-depth research, but also the creativity and the art that's kind of flowing through this.
Well, did you want me to maybe read a passage?
Yes, absolutely. Yes, please.
Okay. All right. This is a passage at the beginning of the novel in the first chapter, and it's a minor character. There are many characters here, even though it's the novel revolves around the life of Caleb. But this is a minor character who is works as a valet in the house of a large plantation, because the Hollyfield plantation is a large sugarcane plantation in southern Louisiana. And he had been a field hand in the earlier part of his life, but he was injured and then ended up having to come into the house and to kind of work as the personal valet of the slave master.
Mm.
All right, so here goes. "Thank you, Chester," he mumbled, his fluttering eyelids challenging the sightless sandbags. "You're a good boy, and the Lord's going to bless you for it. May even get to wait on me in the white man's heaven." Chester grinned and knelt on his strong calves as he pulled off Hollyfield's boots. He began massaging the right Achilles heel. "Ah, that feels good. Seems like when my feet feel good, my whole body feels good," said Hollyfield. Chester removed Hollyfield's socks, ran his hands along the sole and in between the pale arthritic toes of the right foot. Gripping the heel, he twisted the upper part of the foot around in a circle. "Wait on him in the white man's heaven." Thought he was already waiting on him in the white man's heaven. And if a nigger's heaven wasn't nothing but serving white folks again, then he'd rather have the worms eat him and never rise to see the sun or hear the mockingbird's liquid song or leaves flapping in the breeze, shaking off the dew, or steamboats plowing upstream, calling to mind a new and better day. He just begged the Lord to let him stay in the tomb and rest his broke-down body. White folks sure think niggas is fools if they think niggas is looking for to serve them in heaven. Nigga, heaven ain't got nothing to do with no white folks. They the fools if that's what they think. Milkweed head. Hollyfield's eyes were closed and his mouth hung open. Chester cut a hateful look at him. The gall of some folks was harder than a sledgehammer. Eyes closed. Wasn't nothing in them to see with. Nothing but hard blue dots that hid the mystery of life. No color, no substance to the pale, soft feet. How could they have traveled across the land and made big holes in the earth with such weak feet? He'd wonder about them feet and the greed that pushed them around, sucking the blood from the earth. White man wasn't nothing but a mosquito, had to suck the living sap in a man for life, couldn't live without taking a man's blood. Never could rightly understand why a nigga was damned, cause his skin was black and solid and tough as a mule's hide. Nigga just had to accept it, though. Wasn't nothing else he could do but work himself half to death to keep the other half alive. Didn't believe in no angels coming blowing bugles after no niggas, not after God put his curse on them. He stared at his dark skin, ashamed and feeling a pain in his heart deeper than the sting of the lash. It always hurt to think that what he was could never change lessen he died. Couldn't nothing on God's earth make him white except his ashes after they cool from the flaming eyes of white men. Wouldn't nothing change for him? Wasn't nothing for a nigga but being dumb and deaf to his misery? Wasn't never gonna change. Nothing could break the curse of God but his mercy. Chester tilted his head to the side and started stroking Hollyfield's left foot, sighing inside himself so the master didn't hear, and crying, but he couldn't let no tears come out. He'd catch hell if he did. White folks didn't like niggas showing no feelings except a hog swallowing up his own youngin'. Mean mistresses, hard drivers, haughty half-breeds and footstools like him that never had nothing. No woman, no youngins, no mammy or pappy that he ever knew about. Nothing but a pulpy white foot that smelled bad as old fungus rags kept too long in armoires. No land but what his hands had touched in the rich red fields full of vigor and peace. It was lots better in the sun. It was lots better than being a footstool and a fool sliding around grinning all the time like it was something worth grinning about with your head in a wildcat's mouth. It was better in the fields. Didn't have to play at loving no man while he whooping on your black hide and working you till you can't sweat no more. To be a loving, grinning ass. Hell, even asses get tired and refuse to move. And if the master lash or shoot them in the head, don't matter at all. There was niggas and there was mules to do the work of the world. But a mule had more sense than a nigga any day. Sense enough to demand some victuals and rest when he needed it. Niggas too scared to do nothing but cow down like some creature that ain't even of this earth. Broadbush got sense enough to keep his thorns. Niggas been tricked. Niggas been tricked out of their senses. They don't know what a pen is for. Don't know how they got in or how they're gonna get out. So they just stay put like a circle of stones marking a grave, a death they ain't rightly remembered or forgot. When the white man first fell into their souls and ate them.
Wow.
Again, the psychological,
right,
you know, musings of a man, you know, who's waiting on his master. And see, because we think, oh, the house, being in the house was, okay, that was the best place to be. You got treated better, the work wasn't as hard, da-da-da, no.
Right.
Absolutely not.
Let's push on that point because that's a very, very important point, this idea of the house enslaved African and also the field enslaved African, this whole dichotomy that is actually a misnomer.
Actually, it is. And I tried to show that here, even though I had to cut some of the chapters out. When I first finished the book in 85, it was 1,000 pages long.
Oh, my goodness.
So I had to cut out 4 chapters.
No, that's wonderful. That's a lot of writing too. I'm inspired.
A lot of it had to kind of be cut down.
But before we wrap this up, there was some ethics here in this passage that I pulled out. Humanity, a different conceptualization of humanity, the idea of freedom, and also clearly resistance that was in here. What about your research that kind of informed you to kind of creatively put all of this history into something? It's just a passage, but this is the whole book. But what is the history? What part of history that you were reading, something that you read that kind of inspired you to write that?
Yeah, when I went to New Orleans, I was doing research at the Amistad Research Center, which it used to be a house, a center right there in the French Quarter, but I understand now they've moved to Tulane University. But there was a lot of documentation there, and I was reading letters by Governor Claiborne, who was the first governor of Louisiana. The American governor, that is, of Louisiana, and he was writing letters to James Madison asking for federal troops to put down the Maroon communities. Now, they called them brigands or bandits, but that's what they called Maroons, like the authorities, because they were so numerous, and the militias and the patrols, the state militia and patrols, weren't able to uproot them or put them down. In fact, and this was in their newspapers, they talked about how whenever they tried to go in and take out these Maroons and capture these Maroon communities, that they were never seen again, okay? They were never seen again. It's like, woo, they just disappeared. Now, I tried to bring some logic to it where you actually see a battle. But in their accounts of it, it's like they just vanished in thin air or something like that, okay? Because, again, and you hear a lot of things like that in Louisiana when it comes to Maroons and the voodoo queens and priests in terms of things going that were happening. But anyway, over and over and over, he's writing letters asking for federal troops to put down the Maroons. So you know that they were fighting. And when I really looked again at the American Negro slavery boats, because when I was teaching class, we were teaching a play on Nat Turner. And so some of the students would say, well, other than Nat Turner, what kind of resistance do you have? And I would bring them this list, two pages, single-spaced, of rebellions and Maroon communities that had been attacked of just for Louisiana, 2 pages long. And I could have done that for every state, every slave state. And it was like blew them away. The extent of which these rebellions and Maroon communities existed. Because I thought, well, the Maroon communities, they weren't as big as they were in Brazil and Suriname. But yes, they were. When you look at the community, for example, in Florida with the Seminoles, and we think of Seminoles, we think, oh, Indians. No, it was Native peoples who were aligned with African Maroons who had already been in Florida for almost a century. And then the Creeks break off, and they come down, and they form the Seminole Nation, or Confederation, which was a confederation. You have different nations within the confederation, and the Seminole Maroons, or some people call them the Black Seminoles, was one of them. But they were the main fighters among the Seminoles, because they were the ones that Andrew Jackson, Zachary Taylor were coming to get them, right, saying, oh, these are our slaves and we're going to bring them back. So they were the main targets, and they were the major fighters in the Seminole Wars. The Seminole Wars were the biggest wars that were fought against the United States among the so-called Native peoples. So when we talk about Nat Turner having the largest rebellion, that's not true, even though his rebellion is significant for other reasons, very significant, and I believe the man was a prophet, and which many other people do, because they have whole groups, especially in the prison industrial complex, that worship Nat Turner as a prophet, or uphold him, I should say, as a prophet. And I would suggest to everybody to please go see the film Birth of a Nation about Nat Turner. But it was by no means the largest rebellion, because they're not counting, number one, the rebellions that were taking place in the 18th century in Louisiana under the French and under the Spanish. And what's also fascinating, I was just in the, I got a chance to go to the new museum in D.C., the National Museum of African American History and Culture, and they have a section there on Louisiana, slavery in Louisiana, because of the uniqueness, I guess. But in that section, they had something, I copied it down, that the largest Maroon communities, this is what they say, the largest Maroon communities were in Louisiana, and that the Maroons controlled large parts of the Louisiana Territory. Now, when they say Louisiana Territory, they're talking about all the territory west of the Mississippi to the Pacific, right? Because this is before the War of Independence. They're saying by 1775, the Maroons control vital parts of the Louisiana Territory. And I said, wow, because even in my research, I didn't find that they were the largest. I thought the Maroon community in Florida was the largest. Then I'm just reading something today where they say, no, the largest was in South Carolina. You get varying accounts, and then, of course, there's the Dismal Swamp, where they say 30,000 enslaved Africans came out of the swamps, Maroons, after the Civil War had ended. So these were large communities, and, again, people came off the boat fighting in many cases. So you had Africans that had joined up with the Natchez Indians, hundreds of them who fought in wars against the French, where it was hundreds of French soldiers that were killed. You had Africans who had joined up, who fled and got in joint, set up Maroon communities and aligned themselves with the Coromanches. It's in southern Louisiana, again, and they're fighting the French and, again, killing hundreds, perhaps thousands of French soldiers. The Seminoles and the Seminole Wars, they killed more American soldiers than all of the Plains Indians wars put together, over 1,500, and that's not even counting the militia and far more of the militias, you know, that were deployed against the Seminoles in the Seminole Wars. So there's just a lot, and the thing, too, is there's a lot of information. There are a lot of primary sources that have still not been tapped or still have not been exhumed, and that's another thing that I've you know, discovered when I was doing research in Louisiana at the Amistad Center. There's tons of information, a lot of it in French and Spanish.
Mm-hmm. I'm talking with Dr. Nubia Kai, historian, teacher, scholar, activist, artist, and you have provided a very, very important work, and I say that with all sincerity. I spread my wings and I fly.
Right.
I want to thank you for taking the time to talk with us today, and we will be in touch soon.
Thank you so much for having me. Thank you, Dr. Pope.
Conceive true deception and multiply it a millionfold. Visualize the yin and yang in a battle so intense that we get them confused. The resident evil specializes in misconstruing. We want to be at a presidential level. What are we doing? Fooling ourselves, clowning ourselves, playing ourselves, but not being ourselves. We can't babble no more than we can bob our head off beat. Nimrod by the time we 40 cause we can't get off meat. Why we ask no reason for the misplacement of the season. Look at the picture that's painted, tainted as a mind that's blinded to the point where sodomites get all the rights. We fall for fights with fisticuffs, get pissed enough to miss the bus. It disgusts me to see my folks run up on. I say stand up on the section of time all revelations and recognize this mind-numbing reality of horror known as mankind. Jesus and his 12 disciples make 13, a righteous number of righteous men. Even Judas the betrayer came true in the end. The devil say the end is the beginning. They teach that we were the product of incest. Invest no level of self into this system of pagan numbers. Stand with us and don't look back upon this faceless mind state, otherwise Babylon. Babylon.
That's it for Africa World Now Project for this week. I would like to thank you for joining us today and look forward to spending time with you next week. We can be reached through all your regular social media platforms.
email africaworldnowproject@gmail.com or follow us on Twitter at AFWRLDNWPRJ. I am your host and producer, James Pope. The Africa World Now Project Collective consists of international media journalist, executive producer, and human rights activist, Moise Muntali, Africa World Now Project international media correspondent, Funa Ngonda, and technology advisor, Byron Gray of Grayworks Technology. Africa World Now Project is heard every Wednesday at 7 p.m. on WSNC 90.5, a broadcasting service of Winston-Salem State University. Until next week, be safe, be peaceful, and above all, be intelligent. Lyrical miracles, these are pyramids from the imperial. In theory though, low end scenario, and soundboy Berrio drove me to classic material. Aerial nights blew my mind out of stereotypes for ethereal heights. I write like Richard, invisible man picture below with the hieroglyphicable, prolific flow on the walls where the mystics are chemical to go. Supreme wisdom in my system is the kick in the dough. I don't rhyme for the sake of riddling, no, this is a ritual. Before those depicted as low, now I pass life like I've been here before. The reincarnation of it takes a nation, a million, so hold us back. Coldest raps for me, the globe is like a cul-de-sac. Around the world in a day, fine forever, and I stay. I'm from the weather where they spray. There's got to be a better way. People dying every day. Wonder what would heaven say. Devils need to get away. From Chevrolet to Escalade, from Evergreen to the Everglades, I kneel where the rebels pray. Seen 50 grave, but they need better shades. Rhyming like they whole style in retrograde, the escapade I'm on. It's like when the sun, moon, and stars is born. It's hard to explain how these pyramids form. Tell them that I got purples off the spot. MCs, I'll be burning hot. Tell them that I got purples off the spot. MCs, I'll be burning hot. Tell them that I got purples off the spot. MC, I burn it, I will. I arrived on the planet, never took the south for granted. Smoke a little, keep a high standard. The roots of my so I got a fly bandwidth. Son of the sit-ins, you know who I stand with. Dude said I was a hero, I ain't nothing but a sandwich. A gluten-free one and that, close my eyes, see my raps. My bio is feedback for what we need, rap on some Marshawn Lynch. Let me run it back. And come with that new black spiritual. Every rap's a miracle, condition that critical. Can't lack lyrical, we need black generals. Holy war, tap into you like Savion. But I'm an orator, the corduroy boy came. The door-to-door name, down the corridor of fame. I walk like an Egyptian on a mission to listen to conditions and vision. A vision of what we wishing. I've been commissioned to deprison the prism of your mind. Spit the wisdom of the one divine. Close encounter of the wonder kind. Front of line, shift the paradigm with a pair of rhymes. Style by Michaela, in the suite with Caroline. Getting dressed up under pressure. Alabama shakes on incense rising from the dresser. Child of a fresher God, influenced by the life of the former. Joanne Tessa, Mar, the side of Shakur. I gotta do more. The light-skinned spook who got in the door, I gotta hit four. Same thing Cassius Clay uses pottery for. I'm on a war tour with Muhammad the Prophet, my man. And when we land, the pyramids stand. Tell him that I got four rocks on this spot. MCs, I'll be burning hot. Tell them that I got purples off the spot. MCs, I'll be burning hot. Tell them that I got purples off the spot. MC, I burn it, I will.